And so we'll be in Mark chapter 1. And really where we got started this morning was is that I spoke of just about a couple of passages out of Isaiah. And in Isaiah chapter 7 and Isaiah chapter 9 and also Isaiah chapter 11. And basically what I talked about in those passages of Scripture is the fact that in Isaiah chapter 7, 600 years approximately, really before the birth of Jesus, and I'm just giving you an approximate date. So about 600 B.C., before the time frame of Jesus, God used the prophet Isaiah to say a lot of different things. And some of these things were specifically surrounding the Messiah. The fact that God had a plan, amen, and that the plan was that he had already produced a nation called Israel, his own people. And the thing that's in commonality or similarity between Israel and today's Christian is that we are the people of God. Amen. God's always had his own people, and they're separate. They're different than the world that's around them. And God has been communicating this plan through the ages, and he created this nation through which he could communicate his plan to. And the way that he did that was he spoke through the prophets. And the people of God, they chronicled and they recorded the word that came from the prophets. And in the prophet Isaiah tells us in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, that he would be born of a virgin, that the child would be born of a virgin. And if you've ever read Matthew chapter 2, Matthew interprets it and explains it to us and says, this means Emmanuel is what his name was going to be, that there would be a child born of a virgin, his name would be Emmanuel. And what we're told is that the name Emmanuel means God with us. And so what we need to understand is that since the beginning of the fall and the separation between man because of his sinfulness and the holiness of God, the plan of God is bringing his presence back to his people. Why? Because he loves you. He loves you and he wants to have a relationship with you. Don't hold your head down, Christian. Lift your head up, go on, get your chin up a little bit. Because the enemy of your soul wants to convince you that you are unworthy. He wants to remind you of everything that you've done wrong. He's a liar and the father of lies. And God's business is about loving you and restoring relationship with you. Amen. Hallelujah. And he did it, and he began to explain that he would be born of a virgin. And then in chapter 9, we're told, unto us a son is born. A child is born, a son is given. And the government will rest upon his shoulders. What does that mean? That means that there's coming a day, it's not today, during the millennial reign of Christ. Jesus is coming back, you know that, right? That last song, I didn't plan it. I know, exalt thee, I saw Grace's face. I'm like, the Holy Spirit will show up if she sings. Put it on, didn't even remember all the words to the song, and there it is. I don't know about you, but at the end right there, when it was talking about the fact that she was saying that he's going to reign one day, it started to do something on the inside of me. Could you feel what I was feeling? It started to do something on the inside of me, and I started to just think. I can feel the Holy Spirit right now. That Jesus, oh, he's going to one day be in his rightful place. Amen. All eyes are going to see it. That's why it's called the revelation of Jesus Christ. All the shroud's going to be removed. There's going to be no more obscurity. Human eyes are going to be able to see what they should have been able to see from the beginning of time. That Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's going to come back and he's going to rule upon this earth. And he's going to get the respect, the reverence, the worship that he alone deserves. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And I can feel it burning in my belly in the end of that song. And I can hear Sean calling him King Jesus. And it just was stoking it even more in me. I'm here to tell you, Jesus is going to rule and reign physically upon this earth one day. Right now, he wants to rule and reign in your heart. He wants a throne to sit on. Amen. Amen. And he's looking for a throne to sit on. And the throne that he's looking for is in your heart and in my heart. But there's going to be a God, the government's going to rest on his shoulders. And he was going to promise that he would be the seed of David. And in Isaiah chapter 11, it spoke about the fact that when this day comes, in this millennial reign of Christ, that there's going to be peace on the earth like we've never seen. We don't know what it looked like before the fall. You and I can only imagine what it would have been like before the fall of Adam and Eve. We know that God walked with them in the cool of the day. We know he had relationship with them. He talked with them. He communed with them. But you and I were never there. From the time that you and I came forth in water from our mother's womb, we've been and fallen. I've told you Lauren's analogy many times. And, you know, because many times we start buying into what psychology says. You know that, right? Psychology and the world system is trying to reprogram our mind and our way of thinking. And what they're trying to reprogram us to think is that, you know what, we're all okay. As a matter of fact, that was another thing you used to have at the house. I know we didn't know any better. I'd give you a what high five, Mom, if I could. But, you know, my mom had a lot of little sayings in the house, and I can still remember them. I can still quote them because they were in the bathroom, you know, and as a little kid growing up. But, I don't think the Lord wanted me to talk about this because I think I just, I know what it was. It was just one little quick saying, I'm okay, you're okay. No, no, that's a lie. I'm not okay and you're not okay. But yet psychology would want to convince us of that and would want to convince us that inherently man is all right. No, he's not. If you put two 18-month-olds, you could probably put two 14-month-olds in the same crib with one toy and back up. You will see what's really in the heart. You don't have to teach them that. You don't have to teach selfishness. It's rebellion is bound up in the heart of a child. Because they're born that way. Because they're born of Adam. And what I want you to know is that right now, and I said it this morning, according to Ephesians chapter 2, there's a spirit that is pervasive upon this earth. And it's the spirit of Antichrist. And he works in the children of disobedience. And that spirit is driving people in opposition and rebellion against the things of God. And the whole, I didn't mean to pick on psychology, but we just assumed, the whole field and industry of that is a system to try to fix people in their ways of thinking without God in the picture. That's exactly what it is. It's the wisdom of man without the scriptures, the wisdom of man without God, and they're trying to fix people's mindset, but people's mindset and their minds are completely, for lack of better words, thrown off. They've been enculturated by a world system that has inundated their thinking and has completely taken over everything that they would ever know to do. And without the Word of God coming in and doing its work, they will, none of us, I'm talking about each and every one of us, even as Christians, even though we've given our hearts to the Lord, listen to me, even though we've given our hearts to the Lord and the Holy Spirit lives in our heart, if we do not allow the Word of God to permeate our minds, to permeate our hearts, and to begin to have its way in the midst of our lives, we will continue to think, live, and feel as though everything is fine to continue to live like the world. And I'm here to tell you, God's not okay with it. Jesus is going to rule and reign again, like I said, and right now he wants to start today. He wants to start today by ruling and reigning on the inside of our hearts. But hallelujah, when one day, whenever Jesus comes back to rule and reign, it will no longer be the spirit of Antichrist that is so powerful in the air, moving humanity away from God. Instead, it will be the spirit of Jesus. And then during that time frame, it says that the wolf will lie with the kid, which is a baby goat. It says that a baby will be able to put their hand on a hole where there's a poisonous snake. It says that a lion will eat straw like an ox. That it's going to be peace like you and I could never imagine. That's what we're looking forward to. 600 years before Jesus was ever born, it was already being prophesied that this was going to take place. And in Mark chapter 1, which we're about to read, is whenever it was fulfilled. All the promises that God had given for all of those years, he had been telling his people time and again. And now we read in Mark what God's plan had to do with. And I want you to see this tonight, that there's a progression even within the midst of this story that affects our lives individually. God stepped in, amen, in the midst of human history, and he did something. He did something, and forever, everything's different. And if you'll let him in, your life, everything's going to be different. This morning I told the congregation, I said, this is a dangerous place to be. I told them that this was a very dangerous place to be because I knew this morning that the Holy Spirit was speaking. And what I meant by that was this, is that if you don't want to be changed, this is a dangerous place to be when God is speaking. I'm not talking about the preacher. I'm talking about when God begins to speak forth his word, it's a dangerous place to be because inevitably, things are going to change one way or the other. God's word will not return unto him void. It will accomplish that which it set forth to do. And when the word of God is going out and it's entering into your heart and you continue to allow yourself to sit in the presence of the word of God, something is going to change. The same word, the same sun that hardens clay, softens butter. The same word that softens a heart will also harden a heart. If the neck is stiffened and the head is hardened and we become stubborn against the word of God, our hearts will begin to gain a callus, a layer of fat on top of it, and it will be incapable of receiving the holy word of God, and it will not do, it's going to accomplish something. It's going to accomplish the opposite of what we want it to be. But I got good news for you. You don't have to stress out and think you got to fix yourself. I'm telling you right now, I just want to invite you to keep on coming back. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday, whenever you can make it, you just come back. You just sit back. You let God speak the word of God to you. You open up the word of God. You start reading the word of God. And I'm telling you right now, something's going to start happening to you. Something's going to start happening to you, and you're going to start to see something changing on the inside as the seed of the gospel begins to move in the midst of your life. 600 years later, Jesus is born. It says in St. Mark chapter 1, verse 1, and we're just going to try to read all the way through verse 28 before we start speaking about it. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord and make his path straight." John did baptize in the wilderness and preached the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea, they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel's hair and with a girdle of a skin about his loins, and he did eat locusts and wild honey. And preach, saying, "There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose. I indeed have baptized you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost." And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, "Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered unto him. Now after that, John was put in prison. Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel." Now as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said unto them, "Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when he had gone a little further thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who also were in the ship, mending their nets. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. And they went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority and not as the scribes. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold thy peace and come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, he came out of him. And they were all amazed insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commanded he even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him." And immediately his fame spread abroad throughout all the region round about Galilee. Lord, we thank you for your precious word, O Lord. And once again, I ask that you would speak, Lord God, and that Holy Spirit, you would reveal Jesus to us in a way like never before. Lord, I pray that we would understand him so much better when we leave tonight than what we did when we got here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So this morning we talked about the fact that John the Baptist. Now listen, Isaiah talked about John the Baptist also. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, he talked about the fact that there would be a messenger, a voice of one crying in the wilderness. I talked to you, I'm going to repeat a little bit of what I said this morning, but really I didn't get into the message very much, to be honest with you. But it says here that he was to prepare ye the way of the Lord. And that John the Baptist preached a message of repentance, a baptism of repentance. And that all that area came out to him in order to be baptized. And the purpose for that was that their hearts would be prepared for Messiah. Once again, remember, Messiah means anointed one. Remember that God had been for thousands of years promising that he would come, and now he's here. But the people find themselves in the midst of a time frame of human history where their hearts have been hardened by religion. Even the people known as the Jewish people, who were the people of God, they're not really allowing the law, if you will, to enter into their hearts, and for it to be the spirit of the law, for it to deal with their hearts, that they would love the God that they serve. Instead, they're going through a bunch of rituals, a bunch of rote rituals, and trying to practice law and focused upon self-performance instead of letting God really reach into their hearts. And here they are in the midst of this time frame, and John the Baptist is sent by God as a forerunner to prepare the way. You know, in ancient times, they would always send a messenger before the king came. I told y'all that this morning, right?
Yeah.
It was for the purpose of preparing the roads. We had a couple of people that weren't here this morning, so I'm going to give them a little bit of this morning. Amen? They were serving the church. The servant would always come in, and he would be there to prepare the roads. The king's coming. He would not only prepare the roads to have a smooth arrival for the king, but he'd also probably have a scroll, and he'd bring a proclamation. The king's coming. You need to prepare yourself. The king of the province, he's coming. Amen. And I was thinking about roads this morning when I woke up. I told the church this. I thought about potholes. Because, see, John the Baptist, it was the forerunner for Jesus, and the people's hearts had to be softened in order to receive Jesus. And I asked the people this morning, and I'm going to ask you again because we have a new crowd tonight, how many John the Baptist showed up in your life before you were ready to really receive Jesus? You understand what I'm trying to say? How many people showed up and told you about the Lord? And as I was sitting in my bed this morning, I woke up, I was thinking about the preparation of a road. And for them, it was physical in those days, but for us, it's a spiritual thing. And I was thinking about potholes for some reason. Have you ever run into a pothole? I'm telling you right now, I don't pay enough attention when I'm driving. But whenever I run into a pothole, I cringe. Sometimes I hit them things so hard I hear metal hit the road. And when it happens, something cringes on the inside of me. Have you ever ran into a Christian that was like a pothole in your life? A John the Baptist pothole, preparing you to receive Messiah. Because, see, the first time you were just going about your business, doing your thing, amen, and all of a sudden they showed up and they intruded in the midst of your circumstance, and they told you your life isn't right. Things that are going on in your life aren't right. Oh, preacher, God doesn't use people like that. Will you go on and believe that? God will use people like that, and I hate to admit it, but I know that he's made me a pothole Christian, and he's going to use me that way. He might call you to come behind me, like I said this morning, and smooth things out. And if that's what he's called you to do, hallelujah. We can work as a team. But in the meantime, I pray that the fire of the Holy Spirit will burn in my belly, and that I'll be a pothole. And when the time has come, and it's time to call out sin, and it's time to call what the Word of God says, that people would hear it, and that their hearts would be prepared by the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Jesus is coming back, church. I got to tell you, he's coming back. Hallelujah. And he wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to, and God wants to intrude in the midst of your life. Everything's not cool. Everything's not copacetic. No, God wants to intrude in the midst of your life. That's what he did. He intruded in the midst of humanity. He showed up. He revealed himself. He's given promises, and now he showed up. So here's the forerunner, and he's baptizing a baptism of repentance. You know, repentance means to change your mind. The whole world at that time, and even the whole world today, has a particular mindset. So I've already mentioned some of that. Oh, for the most part, mankind's okay. No, we're not. Wrong mindset. I mean, if I could really make good sound effects, I'd be like, wrong answer. No, everything's not okay. That's why Jesus had to die on the cross. And the severity of sin speaks of that. God showed me this morning, this is a message of love, son, but people got to be reminded, you got to be reminded, preacher, of the severity of sin. Sin will destroy us. Sin has destroyed humanity, and it causes separation between us and the presence of God. He was a voice crying in the wilderness. You know, there's about five scenes that I see here. We see the scene of John the Baptist, and he's preaching and he's baptizing. And the next thing you know, we see a change in a scene where Jesus comes to be baptized. Amen. And then immediately it says he's driven, another scene change, into the wilderness where he's tempted of the devil. And then we see another scene change where he's walking by the Sea of Galilee and he calls the disciples. And then one last scene change that we're talking about this morning, where he enters into the synagogue, he begins to preach. And this man with an unclean spirit, he's demon possessed, he reveals himself. And so we see Mark is writing with rapidity. He's writing very rapidly, but he's yet at the same time, he doesn't tell us as much detail as some of the other narratives of the Gospels, but he uses specific words that paint a picture. Adjectives or words in the Greek language that give so much power and give us so much revelation of what's really going on. And so here's the first scene, John the Baptist, and what he looks like and what he's preaching. And the Bible says right here in verse 9, it says, it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway, coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Now, I just want you to get a picture of this. The Bible says that the heavens were opened. The word in the Greek there is schizo. It's where we get the word schizophrenia. But what the idea is that it was torn. I told y'all that this morning. This is the last thing I told y'all this morning. From here on, it's all new. It's as though God tore the heavens open. Now, one of the things I forgot to tell you this morning, and I felt like God put on my heart also this morning when I was lying in the bed before my feet hit the floor, was I want you to remember the last scene of Genesis chapter 3. I want you to remember the last scene. Because the last scene of Genesis 3, mankind has fallen. Mankind has fallen and taken sin into himself, and there's been a separation between his sinfulness and the holiness of God. And the last scene of that chapter has Adam and Eve expelled from the garden with two cherubim with flaming swords, representing judgment. The flame of sword is a judgment, preventing their access back into the garden. And all this time through human history, God is working his plan of salvation. And now in this moment of time, we see this scenery take place. This literally happened. You and I weren't there, but I got to tell you, God intruded in the midst of human circumstances. He ripped heaven open. Mankind, the last scene we see is that he's over there and he's prevented from getting into the access or the presence of God. And here we see God ripped the heavens open. God, the heavens are ripped open and God reaches down. He said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. He wanted us to know that he was well pleased with the beloved one. The word is agapetos. It means that he's the only one. There's no other like him. There's a special relationship between the Father and the Son, because the Son is, he's altogether lovely. He's altogether beautiful. He never does the wrong thing. He always does the right thing. He's the obedient one. He's the righteous one. Amen. And God the Father says, I love him. He's my beloved one. And so because of the fall of man and the fact that man's been expelled from the garden, but now God reaches is in and he wants to communicate with mankind. He wants to communicate with you tonight.
Yes.
He wants to have a relationship with you tonight. He tore heaven open. Hallelujah. He tore heaven open and he communicated with mankind. This is my beloved son. Hallelujah. And he wants you to know that if you will receive Jesus, we're kings and priests. If you will receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can also be found in the Beloved One. God can now have a relationship with you. God can walk with you. Amen. God can talk with you. And so I just wanted you to see that the heavens were torn open, that God intruded in the midst of humanity. So don't get angry whenever a Christian intrudes into your life, because God wants to intrude into people's lives. He may not always use people like me. He might use people with different personalities, right? We're not all the same. Amen. He might use you. You might have a soft-spoken spirit about you. You might say things real sweet and praise God, because we sure need a lot of you. Amen. But nevertheless, he wants to intrude into people's lives. Do you understand that if he doesn't ever get an opportunity to intrude into their lives, that they're just going to be wandering around in a wilderness, lost, without knowing the things of God, and that their eternal soul will perish? Lord, cause our hearts to hurt for lost souls. What have we done? Have we fallen asleep again? Has the preacher fallen asleep again to the point where our hearts don't hurt, and that we're not concerned about the souls of those that don't know our Jesus? Lord, stir something up on the inside of us. Amen. Make us hungry. Make us thirsty for the things of God. So the voice spoke and said, he's my beloved son. In him I am well pleased. And immediately the spirit driveth him into the wilderness. See, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Mark doesn't say a whole lot. He doesn't talk a whole lot really about the baptism scene, other than he uses that word schizo. The Holy Spirit tells him, no, the Holy Spirit told Mark, you tell them I tore heaven open. I want them to know that I love them and that I have a plan and that I tore heaven open and that I intruded. And now the Bible says the Spirit driveth him. Driveth him into the wilderness. It's not as though the Holy Spirit's got to be behind Jesus pushing him from his back, saying, oh, you got to go because Jesus doesn't want to go. That's not the idea. He's being compelled by the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, he's got singleness of mind. Jesus has one purpose, one thought. He must accomplish the Father's will for his life. And what we see is that he enters into this wilderness experience. And the Bible says, I never even really paid that much attention to it before, he was there amongst the beasts. It was a barren place. A place that was hostile. I don't know what the story was on the beasts. I don't know if it was a tactic of the enemy, of fear, and that, or whatever the case. But whatever it was a temptation, it was a testing like none of us have ever experienced. The enemy of our soul, Satan himself, tempted our Savior, tested him, put him to the test for 40 days. And the scripture, it talks about the fact that he was in this situation. And I began to think about the fact that the first Adam was in a pristine, peaceful paradise when the serpent showed up and tempted him and caused him to fall and go the way of the serpent. Caused him to bring sin into himself, wreaking untold havoc on the human race. And here we have the Son of the Living God, the Beloved One, who now is driven into the wilderness, and unlike a peaceful paradise, a chaotic, confusing place of temptation like you and I would never know, yet he comes out victorious on the other side. I don't know about you, but the more I thought about this passage of scripture, the more I thought about this scene right here where Jesus is being tested or tempted by the evil one and that Jesus comes out victorious. I wrote it in my notes. I said, thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. We needed that. We really needed that, because we were really in a bind down here. Because we couldn't accomplish anything. We were naked. We were destitute. We had no strength on the inside. Don't look at me like you're all holy. Like, oh, well, I ain't never did what you did before, preacher. Well, that's good. I'm glad that you never did what I did. But guess what? You were born of Adam. You were born in sin. And if you hadn't even done what I did, you at least thought about it a time or two. And I can tell you that in the eyes of the Lord, it's just as bad if you sat there and you coveted and you thought about it. And what I need you to know is this, is that our Jesus was victorious. That was the first thing that he had to do. The first Adam failed, and now all of humanity born of him has been born fallen. The last Adam came off victorious and gave us the opportunity, amen, to be born again in him. Hallelujah. He's our representative man. He overcame the enemy, and I thank God that he did, because you and I, we can't do it. We need him. Amen. I don't know about you, but the preacher needs him. He needs his victory moving and operating in the midst of his life. Yes. And then there was a change to the next scene. And in the next scene, it says that, well, before the next scene, it says, now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee and he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. I need you to get a picture of this, that the gospel of the kingdom of God, once again, is that God has brought his kingdom to the midst of this earth. Remember, he tore heaven open. He intruded into the midst of our circumstances. He gave us Jesus, light, life in the midst of darkness. Jesus, the kingdom of God, is resident in him. I didn't really think to put the scripture, but in Matthew 12 and 29, Jesus tells a story. He cast out a devil. He cast out a devil in this story. But he cast out a devil, and the religious leaders of the time accused him of casting out devils by the prince of devils, Beelzebub. And Jesus says, no, but if I cast out devils by the hand of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. The kingdom of God showed up in Jesus, hallelujah, in physical form upon this earth. And then Jesus said this. He said that you can't spoil a man's goods, meaning you can't take his possessions until you first bind the strong man. What does that mean? That means if somebody's going to go try to take a man's possessions out of his house, you have to first bind the strong man, the owner of the house, because he's not going to just let you carry off the things that are in his house. The enemy of your soul is the strong man of this world because of the fact that Adam gave him dominion when he fell. Jesus came to bind the strong man. And what Jesus did as he endured temptation and came off victorious and gave his victorious life in our stead on the cross, he defeated the power of the enemy. And now you and I in Christ can partake of the kingdom of God. It's on this earth. There's two kingdoms that are coexisting. The kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of God coexisting upon this earth at the same time. And when you and I say yes to Jesus and also surrender our lives to him, now the presence of the Holy Spirit is moving and operating in the midst of our lives, and Jesus will bind the strong man in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
He's saying the kingdom of God is at hand. The time is fulfilled. Hey, the Father's been telling you through the Holy Spirit and the prophets all this time. Now it's here. And so I need you to understand that it's here, but that the final fulfillment is still lies ahead on the horizon. And today is the day to choose whom we will serve. Amen. Joshua said that. Choose you this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. And Lord, I pray that you'd put it in each and every one of our hearts, that we would make the choice on the inside of us to serve you. Amen. To serve the Lord. And so he said, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Do you believe the gospel? Do you believe the truth, amen, that God sent his son to die on the cross? Do you believe it enough to let it have its way in your life? Do you believe it enough to want to share it with other people? Has it affected you that much? I didn't ask you how messed up things have been the last couple of weeks. I asked you, has it made itself real enough in you to want to share it with others, to let them know that God is real and that he's working in the midst of your life. Amen?
Amen.
It says then, as he had gone to Galilee and he was preaching, verse 16. Now as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. Verse 17. And Jesus said unto them, Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when he had gone a little further from there, he saw James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, who also were in the ship, mending their nets. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. Now I noticed in verse 16, verse 18, and in verse 19, the word net was used three different times. You know, a lot of times the way that people and most preachers have preached this passage of scripture, and I'm not saying that it's completely wrong, and I'm sure many of them have already used it with me. What they would say is that once you get your call, you're supposed to put down your day job and you're supposed to go preach the gospel. Well, you know, I've already used Paul as an example before. He made tents throughout the entirety of his ministry. He never did stop making tents, and many times he refused to take an offering so that he could continue to preach, amen, and make tents on the side so that he didn't put a burden on the people. But one of the things that the Lord showed me is that these nets were their life. You understand that they were fishers. You wake up in the morning and you make sure that you're now. I don't know anything about fishing, and very seldom have I cast a net, okay? I've tried a couple of times. You don't want to be on my team if it depends on us catching fish. All right, you might know somebody else that's good. If times get tough, you pick the right one. But what I want to tell you is this. Is that whenever a fisherman, I know enough to know this, that if they were fishing with nets, they took care of those nets. They made sure in the morning before the sun was up that the nets were ready to go. They got in the boat and they began to cast those nets. Probably right when the sun was rising, maybe even before that, they started casting nets. And they're casting nets all day long. And not only are they casting nets, but they're pulling in their catch. They're pulling in fish into the boat. And at the end of the day, they're cleaning their nets. And if their nets are okay, they clean their nets. But then they gotta sell the fish, they gotta cook the fish, and they gotta eat the fish. And what I'm trying to tell you is that if the nets are messed up, then they're mending the nets. The point that I'm trying to make is this: it's more than an occupation for these men. It's their life. These nets represent their life. And what the Lord showed me this morning was this: is that it's bigger than an occupation and it's bigger than a preaching call. This is a life. And what they did was they forsook their old life and they followed Jesus. And that's part of repentance. And that's part of a turning around. And that's part of really giving your life to Him. The forsaking of the old man and his old ways and a turning around and a following of Jesus. Now, one of the things that I did notice too is this, is that the sons of Zebedee, their net had holes in it. And if the nets represent lives, I believe that the holes are there because of sin. You know, one time, I don't know if you remember this or not, Aaron, I think you might not have even been at the house. I think you'd gone to start a semester at Delgado or something like that. That night, I got a memory about crazy things. But when you weren't there, and I've shared this story with the church before, there was the Luke boys brought somebody to our little Bible study we were having. And this guy showed up out of nowhere, and he worshiped the Lord during the service. And I had never seen him before, but I mean, we had about 25 teenagers that were coming. And I mean, he just got down on his knees and he just started worshiping Jesus. And I can remember asking one of them, I'm like, who is this kid that y'all brought? I mean, he just loves the Lord so much. And they're like, oh, he just moved down here from Houston. So anyway, after the service was over, he came up to me and he said, hey, man, he said, I see things. And I mean, I believe in spiritual gifts. You got to understand that. But I'll be honest with you. Sometimes people can get a little bit weirded out. And so I'm real cautious. I'm careful is all I'm saying. So if you got a gift and God tells you to use it, then please, by all means, use it. And we'll pray and believe God that, amen, that it's really of the Lord. Because I've seen some people that have come across and I don't think it's God. But anyway, that's the first thing I thought. Oh, Lord, here we go. Here's this teenager. What's he going to tell me? So I brought him in the room that you were living with us at the time and brought him in your room. And I said, what you got, man? I said, tell me what you got. He said, dude, I had a vision. And he said that there was a shrimp boat and it had nets. and the nets had holes in them. And I said, what does this mean, Lord? And the Lord spoke to my heart and he said, tell him, and he was talking about me, that he has holes in his nets and that the holes represent the sin in his life. And he said, all of a sudden, the nets fell into the water and fish were going through the holes in the nets. And he said, what does this mean, Lord? Tell him that because of the sin and the holes in his life, the fish represents souls and the souls aren't being caught by the net. And in the next scene, he said that there was an old man on the deck and he was mending the nets. And he said, what does this mean, Lord? Tell him that I'm mending the nets. Tell him that I'm mending the nets. And when he said that, the Holy Spirit came all over me. I knew that this kid wasn't flaky, that God had given this boy a gift because he just read my mail. He told the whole story. And one of the things that I began to see in this scene right here was that, guess what? The holes in the nets are because of sin in our life, but it's not just souls that are slipping through. I got to tell you right now, the truth of the matter is that sin will steal things from you. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? You got to believe the preacher when he tells you sin will steal things from you. It will steal your family from you. It will steal your children from you. It will steal the very life out of you. And what I need you to understand is this. Do we care about our children? I'm just asking a question. The preacher's asking about himself, but he's also asking you. Do we care enough about our children that we don't want them to be lost because of the holes that are in the net? Because what I'm trying to say is this, is that God desires to do a work in our lives. And if he can't do a work in our lives, and our children can't see the change in us because we haven't chosen to really live for Jesus, what's going to happen to them? Are we okay with just going through life and the possibility that because of our failures and because of the choices that we made and because of our unwillingness to truly give our lives over and to forsake our nets and to follow after Christ, that we took a chance that their lives, that they never really bought in? Look, Dad, I read the Bible for myself. Look, Mom, I read the Bible for myself. I started reading the Bible. You remember when we went to that church? I would start reading the Bible and I saw a whole bunch in there. I saw a whole bunch in there that wasn't lining up with your life. And what I'm trying to say is this. I realize that if any one of us in here, that people can look in the Bible and they can pick out things in our life that don't look of the Lord, right? I mean, we're all in agreement with that, right? We have not arrived. But at the same time, sometimes it has to do with the spirit behind us, the way that we handle our business. Do we have a humble heart? Are we allowing God to really do a work on the inside of our lives? Amen. I really just felt like the Lord wanted me to share that with you, that you know what? We have holes in our nets, but the Lord wants to mend our nets. We need to forsake that old way of life. Quit trying to fix your own net. Quit trying to fix your own net. Quit trying to figure it out in your own mind with your own plans and your own schemes and your own. Stop all that. Drop that net that's got holes in it. That's your whole life. It's full of sin. Follow Jesus. And if you follow him, praise God, he'll mend your nets, amen? He'll give you a new net, a brand new net, amen? A brand new life. And guess what? You'll stop losing things in your life, but guess what? You're going to start seeing some fish. He said, I'll make you fishers of men. You'll start seeing some fruit in your life, amen? Some souls that are going to be affected by that. After this scene here, we're entering into our last scene where it says that they went into Capernaum and straightway on the Sabbath day he did enter into the synagogue. Now, I don't know if you know what a synagogue, during that time, they didn't do sacrifices in the synagogue. It's kind of a long story, but you know what? We'd like to teach the Bible here too. There was a time frame, probably about 586 B.C., about 586 B.C. where the Babylonians conquered Israel. And from that time, and the prophet Malachi was the last prophet in the Old Testament. At some point in time, King Herod built this other temple that was in Jerusalem. And once King Herod built that temple, they were offering up. I say he built the temple, he added on to the second temple. And once they had that temple, They reinstituted the sacrificial system. But during this time frame right here, they didn't have a temple, they didn't have staff, or they didn't have any sacrifices. They started building synagogues. And whenever they started building the synagogues, what would happen is that the Jewish men and the Jewish people would go to the synagogue to read the scriptures. And that they would have teachers. It was almost like a kind of like really a free session where anybody could show up. It's almost like somebody could show up over here. We'd all be sitting down. Somebody would say, turn in Isaiah, let's read it. And then somebody would just stand up and start teaching. And that's basically what was happening. All you had to have in any city or province was 10 Jewish men, and you could build a synagogue. And so I'm just kind of giving you an idea. So they had synagogues all over the place. Just like they got churches on every corner, they had synagogues all over the place. And Jesus's custom was that he would go to the synagogue and he would read the scripture and he would teach. That's what Paul would do too. He would go to the synagogue, he would read the scripture, and he would teach. And so it says that he showed up at the synagogue and he taught. The Bible says that they were astonished at his doctrine when he taught. I mean, again, the word astonished is very strong. Once again, Mark's using another strong word. It's like they were really amazed at the power with which Jesus taught. It was different than the scribes. The scribes were also known as lawyers of the law. And what they did was is that they just copied the words over and over again. They were transcribers. And with time, they would just write and write and recopy and recopy. And because they did that so many times, they became familiar with the Word of God. But really and truly, they knew a bunch of rules. They knew a bunch of regulations. But they didn't really have the power of God moving and operating in the midst of their life. And so when Jesus showed up and he began to preach the gospel with the power of the Holy Spirit, the people were astonished. They were amazed. It's like they were looking at each other in each other's eyes like, what in the world is this? What's going on? This is something completely different than anything that we've ever experienced before. And all of a sudden, what you need to understand is that when the Word of God is going forth and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is behind the Word of God, things that aren't right start to come up. Now, it might be a little bit different, amen, in a modern church setting. It might not, I don't know. But if you sit under the anointed Word of God long enough, there's things in your life, amen, that are going to start coming up. It's going to start revealing itself. It's going to start being exposed, because that's what the Word of God does. It begins to expose things in your heart. I can remember one time I was preaching over there in Franklin, and I'll just tell you, because he said it, he said it to the congregation before. The mayor of Franklin over there, he's one of the associate pastors, they asked me to teach a Bible study on Romans. They had never heard that kind of stuff before. And after the second teaching, he said, Matt, I'm just going to tell you right now, after the second class, it was like there was an x-ray that you were putting on my heart, and all the stuff that was in there, all the dirt was just being revealed. He said, it made me so uncomfortable. I thought that I was okay. And he said, in reality, I realized that I wasn't. That's the Word of God. That's what the Word of God does. It will begin to expose the things. And especially like if there's a spirit of religion, if there's a spirit of religion that sits on the inside of somebody's heart and they think they got it figured out, I'm telling you right now, they will be the most uncomfortable person that you've ever seen. They will not want to come back. They won't want to come to a church where the truth is being preached, because it will expose that spirit of religion. I'm telling you right now, they may not tell you that they hate it. They may tell you they don't like the preacher. But the reality, and they may not, and I don't blame them. But you know what? It's bigger than that. There's a spirit of religion that's behind that, that's preventing them from really desiring to hear the truth of the gospel. Well, whenever Jesus began to preach with authority and power, all of a sudden this unclean spirit manifested itself. Unclean spirit, he cried out. He used this man's vocal cords and he cried out. And when he said, this is what he said, let us alone. What do we have to do with you? I know who you are. You're Jesus of Nazareth. So he spoke of his humanity. He knew who Jesus was. But he said, you're the Holy One of God. And you know, it's a crying shame that the devils know who Jesus is. And half the world is just, more than half the world, well, who knows how much of the world, is walking around blinded. Amen. By the truth. Amen. Of what God's word says about who Jesus is. Leave us alone. Who are, I know who you are, Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy One of God. And you know what Jesus told him? Jesus rebuked him and said, hold your peace and come out of him. Well, I like when I looked this up in the Greek. The idea is be muzzled. If we were going to say it today, this is probably what we would say. Shut your mouth. That's what Jesus told that devil. Shut your mouth and come out of him. The devil's a liar. You know that. Even though he was saying the truth right there, he doesn't have a plan to bow his knee to Jesus. And you got to understand that. The devil will lie to you. And what God wants the devil to do in your life is he wants him to shut his mouth. Don't let the devil lie to you and try to condemn Amen. You and tell you that you are unworthy. Amen. Jesus died for you. And when the devil starts lying to you, no, you remember and remind yourself who you are in Christ. You remind yourself that Jesus died for you and that he set you free from the power of sin. And you tell the devil, you shut your mouth in the name of Jesus. Jesus has already done the work. Amen. And I've been set free. Praise God. And what ended up happening is that the unclean spirit says when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, he came out of him. He tore him. Means that he became angry in his last act of defiance, threw the man on the ground, came out of it. It says, and they were all amazed in so much that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine? What kind of teaching is this? We've never seen anything like this before. He's just teaching. And all of a sudden, the presence of evil is exposed. And not only that, he tells them to get out, and they obey him. Now, I understand that you and I, thank God, we aren't possessed, right?
Thank God.
But if any one of us, on a little bit of a lesser level, would be honest, we've been tormented before in our lives, many of us anyway, by unclean spirits. We had the thoughts of the ways of the world, and we were being driven by the presence of evil. Being driven towards things that were not of God, being driven towards things, actions and lifestyles that were contrary to the ways of God. And I'm here to tell you that when the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached, amen, it will begin to cause something to change on the inside. It will expose things in your life, but I'm also telling you something else. It will begin to rid things in your life. As you begin to surrender and submit to the will of God, to the word of God, hallelujah, then guess what? The powers of darkness are going to have to relinquish control over your life. And listen to me, this was dramatic, this was very rapid, this was very fast, it was obvious. Sometimes it works different like that. And whenever people are truly possessed, yes, we have authority over devils and to tell them to shut their mouth and to come out. Amen? But sometimes when we're not possessed and we just have a lifetime of sin that's plagued us, we don't even realize what's happening. I'm telling you. I think sometimes of people and where they were in their life. I think of my own life and where I've been in my life and how the Word of God works. And before you realize it, as you've been sitting and hearing and reading and allowing the Word of God to have its way in your life, the power of the gospel begins to change things. Amen? Begins to change your life. It begins to cause those powers of darkness that had a hold on you, that their grip becomes loosened. Amen. And in the name of Jesus, hallelujah, they must flee. Now, what ends up happening is at the end here, and I'm going to close with one more thought after this, but it says in verse 28, and immediately his fame spread abroad throughout all the region round about Galilee. You know, what ends up happening is this, is that whenever you give your life to Jesus, and it just depends on how bad you are. You know, this old boy was bad off, right? I mean, can we all agree? I mean, maybe there's the possibility everybody thought he was okay. Maybe he was going to the synagogue every day and everything was cool. And then all of a sudden he starts acting like that. We're like, man, we never knew Freddie was possessed like that. Did you see that? But the unclean spirit came out of him. You know, that was a very dramatic thing. And what ended up happening is that because of the power they saw Jesus had operated in his life, it caused Jesus to become famous. In other words, people began to publish his name, began to publish the work that he had done. But guess what? In our lives also, whenever there's a change that takes place, whenever we give our heart to Jesus, And the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of our lives. People that used to know us, used to know the way that we were, as we allow the Word of God to continue to change us and move in our lives, and as we begin to tell others, I mean, did you know that your conversation changes with time? Did you know that you start talking different than the way that you used to talk? Amen. The things that you used to talk about, amen? And you start talking about the Lord to the people that you used to talk about other stuff with, it becomes obvious. And guess what? Jesus starts getting famous, amen? He gets a little bit more famous because he changed another one. He changed that one over there. He changed that one over there. And if God's really in your heart, he will change you if you continue to surrender and submit to him. I want to leave you with four thoughts, four things that were torn in my mind. Number one, God tore the heavens. He tore the heavens open and he spoke. And he said, "This is my beloved son. In him, I am well pleased." God wants to know, he wants you to know that he's intruded into the midst of humanity. He tore the heavens open for you. He wants you to know that he loves you. He has a plan for you, amen. And he's just asking you to get on board with him. Number two, the nets were torn. The nets were torn and they represent the sin that's been in our lives and the loss because of the sin that's been in our life. But praise God, if we'll just lay down that old life, quit trying to fix it ourselves, and get up and follow Jesus, he'll give us a new net. He'll give us a new life. The man was torn. The man's life was torn whenever the devil desired to come out of him. He tried to tear him. The enemy of your soul, he still wants to tear you. I need you to know that. He wants to tear you to pieces. Jesus told Peter that Satan desires to sift you as wheat. And I can tell you that he's still trying to do it to people today. He wants to sift you. He wants to separate you from your faith. He wants to separate you from your Jesus. And he wants to destroy your life. The last thing that was torn isn't in this story, it's the veil. The veil was torn in Matthew 27:51. God the Father tore the heavens and he communicated that this is the beloved one, this is the one that I promised would come, he's here. And then once that beloved one goes through the temptation and comes out victorious there and then goes to the cross, hallelujah, and breathes his last breath, the Bible teaches us that the veil in the temple was ripped from the top to the bottom. There was a tear in the veil. What does that mean? It says that it signifies that the way into the Holy of Holies was now made available. What's the Holy of Holies? Behind that veil was the presence of God. No more veil needed. No more ark needed. Amen. The presence of the living God. You and I, when we put our faith in Christ, now the presence of the living God lives on the inside of our hearts. Amen. Amen.